majority of the cases, electronically excited molecules or atoms play a very crucial role, whether it is catalysis or whether it is electronic devices and so on. How fast electron can move, and the speed of electronic devices also depends upon the rate of movement of electrons. Rate of movement of electrons from excited spaces depend on the type of substrate and the distance of the spaces which emit radiation from the substrate. So through this talk, what I will try to emphasize is that whether you take a molecule or take an atom, then if you can have a mechanism to keep this molecular or atomic system at specific distances from the substrate, then try to understand the how the lifetime of the excited species varies. That will have a lot of repercussions in many devices. I will try to discuss this excited state energy transfer through a particular example, but it is applicable in general to many other systems where one can find a mechanism how to place the atomic or molecular species at known distances from the substrate. Substrate could be a glass plate, could be a metal, could be a gold plated substrate. So depending upon the type of substrate, how the excited state decays, how the lifetimes are affected, and the common notion which most of us have, that excited state of atoms or molecules, average excited states have constant lifetime. That is not longer true. The excited state lifetime varies on various factors, including surroundings, including the substrate, the distance of the exciting molecule from the substrate, and so on. So this is what I will try to emphasize in this talk. The excited molecular species, they participate in many dynamical processes like nonlinear optical effects, surface enhanced Raman scattering, catalytic processes. You see, catalysis also takes place through excited species, and depending upon whether the excited species exists for longer time or for a very short time, the catalysis process will be affected. Functioning of electronic devices in a similar way, how fast electronic device can be depends upon the lifetime of the excited species and electron transfer rates. Photochemical reactions, reactions on surfaces, bioenergetics, photosynthesis and electron transfer, photoluminescence, and many other chemical, physical and biological properties. So the excited molecular or atomic species and knowing their decay properties play significant role in many diverse areas, including in the electronic devices and so on. Now, to understand a little complex system, first let us see, if you have a single molecule or atom in the excited state, what are the various pathways through which the energy of the excited molecule will decay and the molecule will come back to ground state? As most of us know, whenever you excite the system, it stays for a certain time in the excited state and then it decays either to the ground state or to various channels. Now, in this diagram, this is the ground state, electronic state, this is the excited electronic state. And these other lines are showing, apart from electronic transitions, vibrational transitions associated with them. So when you use some mechanism to provide sufficient energy to the molecule, from it will be excited from ground state to first excited singlet state. And generally, the lifetime of these singlet excited states is of the order of 10 to the power minus 8 seconds or so. Now, the excited molecules can lose their energy through various channels. Apart from singlet states, there are triplet states, which are always there in the atomic or molecular systems. So, through collision of nearby molecules, because the singlet to triplet transition is not permissible according to dipole selection rules. So they cannot, molecules in the excited singlet state cannot come back to triplet state by emission of radiation or any mechanism. They collide, and then since collision is a process in which no selection rules are operative, so the molecules can collide, and then part of the molecules can lose their energy by coming to triplet state, which has a lifetime of the order of milliseconds. Here, lifetime is of the order of 10 to the power minus 8 seconds. Here, of the order of milliseconds. So this is one way of deactivation of this excited state comes to triplet state, and from triplet state, through phosphorescence, the molecules come to ground state. So the cycle is completed. Another way is the molecules from here through vibrational relaxation comes to the ground electronic state in the excited state, and then they decay to lower energy levels. That gives rise to fluorescence. So you, most of us are familiar, some species fluoresce when you shine light, and the fluorescence originates when molecules from ground state are excited to excited electronic states. Then from excited electronic state, they come back to different vibrational states of the ground state. So there are various processes for isolated molecule. Another process which is shown here is when an excited molecule interacts with another molecule in the ground state and raises this molecule by transferring energy through resonance energy transfer to excited state. So for this process to be applicable, the separation between the two molecules has to be very close, and emission spectrum of one molecule has to coincide with the absorption of another molecule. Only then this type of energy transfer is possible, which is called resonant energy transfer. So the molecule in the excited state interacts with similar molecule in the ground state and transfers this energy from here to this molecule, and this molecule goes to excited state while this molecule comes to ground state. So this is called resonance energy transfer of one excited molecule, whereby it loses its energy by interacting with the similar molecule and raises that molecule to excited state. So this is the case with a single isolated molecular system, and you can see that there are so many channels by which a single isolated molecular species can lose its energy and come back to ground state. So these are the same things which I told, the radiative decay to lower energy states through fluorescence, non-radiative decay due to dipole-dipole interaction. Now, if you have a large number of molecules in a proper assembly, what I will be talking will be about molecular assemblies prepared through LB technique, whereby you can deposit monolayers on substrates, single molecular layers of about 25 angstrom unit thickness. Now, when you have a large number of molecules in a form of a thin film or in the form of LB film, then there are many other channels which become operative for loss of energy of the excited state of the molecules, apart from the processes which are operative for Now, in the case of large number of molecules in the form of thin films or so on, this D indicates donor or some molecule which is excited by radiation of energy H nu, it can go to excited state by absorption of radiation corresponding to the energy levels of the molecule. Then the pathway for its decay is that this comes to ground state and emits energy corresponding to the difference in the energy of the excited and ground state through fluorescence. Or if there is another species like dimers or higher aggregates, then the energy of this can be transferred to this species. So this first species donor comes to ground state, this species gets its energy and is excited, which is called energy trapping of the excited species by another species. Or some aggregates can be formed. Instead of single species, there could be dimers, there could be many other species which are formed in the system. So energy of one excited molecule will be trapped by other aggregates, and so on. So these are the various channels in which a large number of aggregated molecules lose their energy from excited states. So I will concentrate on variation of lifetime and emission properties of molecular monolayers of one molecule which looks complicated, but that is the molecule which can form monolayers of certain thickness, single molecular layers on different substrates. We deposited these monolayers on glass, quartz, and gold-plated glass substrates. We measured the excited state lifetime of those molecular species, and we found that the lifetime, when you measure the lifetime of the excited molecule through time-resolved techniques, compared to the film on glass substrate, and you compare the lifetime on the gold evaporated substrate, the lifetime of the excited state decreases by 4 to 5 orders of magnitude on gold-coated substrate compared to the lifetime on inert surface like glass or quartz. So that is the very drastic result which we obtained in while measuring the lifetime of these excited molecular species prepared by a spatial technique. And both the radiative and non-radiative lifetimes. What do we mean by radiative lifetime? Excited molecule comes back to the ground state, releases its energy in the form of fluorescence. That is called radiative lifetime. When the excited molecule interacts with other molecules and loses energy without giving radiation, that lifetime determination is called non-radiative decay times. So these are two different type of processes by which excited state loses its energy, and their mechanisms are different. So the main conclusion which we will get from this study is that the lifetime, average lifetime of the excited state molecular species or an ion is not a constant. If you plot the lifetime, expectation value of lifetime as a function of distance from the substrate, the variation of lifetime looks like this. So the notion that lifetime is a constant quantity for particular species is not correct. Lifetime depends upon various factors. Lifetime depends upon surrounding dielectric, the type of substrate, and the distance from the substrate. So as you keep on changing the distance from the substrate, the lifetime sometimes may be higher, sometimes it may be lower, again higher. So it is a sort of interference effect. I will discuss why this interference type pattern is observed. So this is what the idea is. How do you understand the variation of this lifetime in terms of various physical phenomena? So we will discuss substrate and distance dependent energy transfer in ordered molecular assemblies of a molecule prepared by LB technique. The techniques which we used were like this: polarized absorption, steady state fluorescence, sub picosecond time resolved fluorescence technique. We used femtosecond lasers, pump probe type technique. We excited the system with 360 nanometer pulse of pulse width 200 femtoseconds. That means 0.2 picosecond pulse width, and then measured the fluorescence at 660 nanometers using mode lock dye laser MCP detector. The fluorescence was detected at QGG 660 nanometers. So this was the main experimental regimen by which you can measure the excited state time by using time resolved techniques directly. You don't have to use line width measurements and things like that. You can directly probe the lifetime using femtosecond laser pulses. Now, I will not go into details of this technique. There is a way to prepare molecular assemblies of some molecules. You dissolve those molecules in some organic solvent, disperse it on a clean and highly purified liquid surface, compress it, and then dip the plates, and you get layers of monolayers of molecules of thickness of the order of 25-26 angstrom units. You can dip 1, 3, 5, 9, 11 layers and so on. So this is one layer. When you have prepared LV film, one layer LV film, there are various molecules which are dispersed in two dimensions. So this is a two-dimensional system. And when you have more than one LV film, then these LV films will be stacked one over the other. Now, in this type of experiment, you can deposit LV film of a molecule whose lifetime you want to measure. Then you can vary the distance by depositing the LV films of some neutral material of known thickness. There are some stearic acids which are known to form LV films of known thickness of 26.4 angstrom units. So what do? You take a quartz plate, you deposit one LV film of the material which you want to study. Then above that you deposit stearic acid of known thickness, deposit another film of the material. That way you can vary the distance: one layer of fatty acid, two layers or three layers. So you can vary the distance of the material whose properties you want to study or whose lifetime you want to measure as a function of distance from the substrate. So we did these experiments by depositing LV films of one porphyrin molecule on glass quartz-plated substrate, and similarly on gold-coated substrate. And then we measured the lifetime using time-resolved technique, picosecond time-resolved technique, directly under different situations. This diagram shows that there is a single LV film like this, which is shown here. And when there are more than one films, these two films are shown here. So if you have one film on a glass substrate, then how the lifetime of the excited state is varying. If you have one layer of LB film, another layer of LB film, then apart from the energy transfer within the same layer, there are molecules in the same layer, there will be energy transfer between the molecules. That is called intralayer energy transfer. When you have more than one layer, then in addition to the energy transfer within the same layer, there will be energy transfer between monolayers of between different monolayers. So energy transfer within the same monolayer, energy transfer between two monolayers. That is interlayer energy transfer. So by measuring the lifetime and getting an expression, this is a standard expression in the literature, the expectation value of the lifetime of the excited species is given by AI tau I square upon summation AI tau I. If there are species which have two or three different lifetimes, depending upon whether they are in isolated state or in aggregated states, then you can get the measure of the lifetime and the intensity of the excited species will, or 1 upon tau, that is the rate constant, will be given by this expression, n k intra plus 2n minus 2 k inter plus r upon tau m upon n. K intra, K inter. These are the rate constants for energy transfer within the layer, same layer, intra layer. Between two nearby layers, inter layer. And the lifetime of the monomer, N is the number of layers. In this example, for three layers, if you have three layers, then the expression for the average lifetime or expectation value of the lifetime is given by this expression. I will come to these results later. This is the molecule which we used to measure the lifetime in the excited state and prepare LV films. It looks complicated, but such complicated molecules only can provide stable monolayers. There are other fatty acids also, which can give you stable monolayers. If you don't have this alkyl chain and other things, then you will get thin film type things, not molecular layers. So this is the molecule which we used to prepare single molecular layers, and then we measured the absorption, normal absorption spectrum. Before coming to time-resolved studies, I want to give you some background, how we characterized whether the molecules are in the proper monolayer form or they are in aggregated form or in lump sum. So we measured the normal absorption and fluorescence of these systems. This figure shows A spectrum. A is the absorption spectrum of the monolayer when prepared on calcium fluoride as substrate. B is on quartz. Now, C is on glass. Now, look at this spectrum D. When you measure the absorption spectrum of LV film of this molecule prepared on a gold evaporated substrate, there is a drastic change in the absorption spectrum itself, which shows that this is on silver-coated substrate. So, which shows that something drastic is happening when you deposit the molecular layers on gold-coated substrate. Then normal fluorescence, this is not time resolved, normal fluorescence also, this is for one layer on, nine layers on gold, and one layer on gold, this fluorescence is almost quenched. You see, fluorescence lifetime or the lifetime of the excited state determines the fluorescence. So if fluorescence is nearly zero, that means lifetime is very, very small. So something has happened on gold-coated substrate, so that fluorescence is almost disappearing. While on glass and other substrates, there is a substantial amount of fluorescence. So these are the preliminary experiments which we conducted to get some idea of what is happening to the molecular films when deposited on different substrates. This is an experiment where we prepared the LB films of the porphyrin molecule, which were separated by fatty acid layers of known thickness of 26.4 angstrom units, one layer of porphyrin and one layer of fatty acid that gave a spectrum. This is one layer of porphyrin. This is the spectrum A. One layer of porphyrin, nine layers of fatty acid. That is the spectrum like this. Now, the purpose of this type of exercise was that you can place the molecular system which you want to study, whose properties you want to probe, at known distances from the substrate by interposing layers of some fatty acid of known thickness. So when you interpose one layer of fatty acid and then one layer of porphyrin, then you know your porphyrin molecule is at a distance of 26.4 angstrom unit from the surface. When you have deposited three layers of fatty acids, then the distance goes to 79 or 80 angstrom units. So you are having your molecule which you are probing at 80 angstrom units away from the substrate. You should try to understand the magnitude of these numbers. We are talking in terms of angstrom units, not in terms of millimeters or micrometers. So these are actual nano devices in real sense, in the sense that we are working at 25 to 100 angstrom unit level. And that means 0.25 to 10 nanometer scale. So these devices are known for a long time. Nanotechnology is gaining importance in recent years, and everybody is talking about nanotechnology. These molecular nanotechnology devices are known since 1970s, and people had been working on them. But nobody noticed or talked in terms of nanotechnology about these systems. So by interposing inert substrates of fatty acids, you can keep the distance of the molecule whose properties you want to study at known distances from the surface. So this is again fluorescence. And when you have multi-layers, then as I told you, if you have a single layer, there are molecules which can interchange energy among themselves within the same layer, intra-layer energy transfer. When you have more than one layer, then in addition to the energy transfer within the same layer, there is a possibility that molecules in one layer and molecules in the next layer, there could be energy transfer between the molecules of these two layers. So this is what it is shown in this slide. Within the same layer, energy transfer between the molecules is given the name intralayer energy transfer. And within the nearby layers, this is one layer, this is another layer, another layer, another layer. So within the layers, the energy transfer between the molecules can also take place, and this is called interlayer energy transfer. We will try to estimate the relative importance of intralayer energy transfer and interlayer energy transfer in addition to the effect of metal surface on energy transfer rates. This is the result of some sub-picosecond time resolved studies. What we did, we measured the lifetime of the excited state of the same molecule in some solvents, then when we deposited one film on glass. So this is the time resolved spectrum, picosecond time resolved spectrum of this molecule in fluorophore and cyclohexane. The curves can be fitted by an expression of the form of intensity at time t is given by Ai e to the power minus t upon tau I. This is the amplitude and this is the lifetime of the species. So this is the emission recorded as a function of time in real time scale using picosecond technique, and you can fit this expression using either one exponential form or two exponential, depending upon whether it is single species which is emitting or more than one species or what. So in chloroform we found that this exponential or decay can be fitted with one exponential with lifetime of 4.2 nanosecond. While in cyclohexane there are two components. One belongs to monomer, lifetime is 4.46 nanoseconds, dimer 1.57 nanomers. Don't bother about this part, this is residual. This is the spectrum which is given for one LV film on glass and 3-9 LV film without any interposition. So different experiments were carried out. Now when we did the same experiment on gold coated substrate, we deposited one LV film and measured the lifetime of the excited state. Major component, 99.2% component, had lifetime of 11 picoseconds. And the second component with 0.8% concentration only, so average lifetime comes to 43 picoseconds. So if we take one component, which is major component, in monomeric case, lifetime was 4.2 nanoseconds, as I showed earlier. When you put this molecule on a metal substrate, the lifetime decreases to 11 picoseconds. So three orders of magnitude change is there in the lifetime. And when we deposit nine layers one above the other, the lifetime is still much shorter than 138 picoseconds. Compared to single layer, the lifetime is higher, but is still much shorter than the lifetime of monomeric species in solution. So these experiments were done on when only porphyrin films were deposited one above the other. When we had only one porphyrin layer, which was separated by neutral layers of fatty acids, one layer, three layers, five layers, 26 angstrom units, 79 angstrom units. So this is the trace which is shown for one LV film on gold evaporated substrate by fatty acid layers. One layer means one layer of fatty acid and one layer of porphyrin film, so 26.4 angstrom unit away. Nine layers means about 230 angstrom units away from the surface, and then you measure the lifetime. So what we got is for one LV film separated by one and nine layers of LV films, the lifetime, average lifetime is 443 picoseconds, and for one layer of LV film after nine layers at or 230 nanometers angstrom units away, the lifetime is 1.2 nanoseconds. Nanosecond is 10 to the power minus 9 seconds, picosecond, you know, 10 to the power minus 12 seconds. So when we extracted all these data and then try to understand what are the reasons why the lifetime of the excited molecular species decreases so drastically on gold evaporated substrate compared to other things, other conditions. We plotted the expectation value of lifetime as a function of distance from the porphyrin film. And the behavior of the lifetime as a function of distance was something like this. And we tried to understand it in terms of a model which has been given in the literature in terms of induced dipole type interactions, Foster mechanism. One molecule in the excited state has induced dipole moment, another molecule also has induced dipole moment, and if the separation between the molecular species is large, so that their emission and absorptions do not overlap, even then the energy can be transferred from one molecule to another molecule through a process which is called induced dipole interaction. So these two dipoles can interact through Coulombic interaction, and if you analyze this in details, there are various theoretical models. I will not go into details of this. The situation comes like this. If you have two isolated induced dipoles, then the dependence of energy transfer rate is proportional to 1 upon r to the power 6. R is the separation between the molecular species. But if you have one dipole and a two-dimensional system, and if you calculate the energy transfer between single dipole and a two-dimensional system, then the dependence would be, energy transfer rate should be proportional to 1 upon d to the power 4. D is the separation between the dipole and the surface. And if it is a three-dimensional system, single dipole interacting with three-dimensional system, then the dependence would be 1 over d to the power 3. We took into account various contributions to the lifetime. The 1 over lifetime is energy transfer rate. And this intralayer energy transfer be considered proportional to 1 upon d to the power 6 if there are two single monopoles. And this energy transfer to a two-dimensional lattice from a single dipole through trapping of energy to dimers and polymers. This is proportional to 1 over 3, intralayer energy transfer and so on. And monomer, we know the lifetime, and 1 upon lifetime of monomer is given here. When we fitted all these parameters, we found that our experimental data is giving us a decay rate which is proportional to 1 over d to the power 1.1 rather than 1 over d cube. And there was a big deviation from the theoretically expected result, which we tried to understand in terms of relative importance of intramolecular and intermolecular transfer rates. These are the numbers given in this tabular form, where when the distance of the molecule from the surface is 26 angstrom units, 79, 132, 236. Then how, this is the amplitude. Amplitude indicates the percentage of particular species with particular lifetime, and this is the variation of lifetime. This is again variation of lifetime separate of porphyrin separated by LB films of fatty acids. This is the type of variation which we observed. Instead of going into details of mathematical complications which was on this previous page, this is the type of equation of Derwin harmonic oscillator which is used to sort out the wave functions and then find out the energy transfer rates and so on. This deviation from 1 over d cube dependence in our measurements is a result of two things. One is that if you consider the excited molecule, dipole, which is interacting with the metal surface, then the electric field of the induced dipole moment will generate surface plasmon modes on the metal surface, or it will induce surface plasmon modes which will radiate. So the dipole will interact with the metal surface, it will induce surface plasmons, and then electric field will be set up on the metal surface. So there is an electric field from the dipole, there is an electric field from the metal surface. Now these two electric fields interfere. When they interfere in a constructive way, then you have higher lifetime. When they interfere in a destructive way, then you have lower lifetime. So the variation in the lifetime, they come due to interaction of the excited molecular species with the surface plasmon modes of the metals. These surface plasmon modes are not present in the case of quartz or calcium chloride because those are insulators. So the lifetime variation on quartz and calcium chloride type surfaces has different variations. It is in the order of nanoseconds, while the lifetime of the excited species on the gold coated substrate goes down to picosecond because of the variation in the excited state lifetime through interaction with the surface plasmon modes of the metal. That is the main finding of our studies. The dipolar field of excited molecule induces surface charge on metal, and the dipoles associated with oscillating surface current sets up their own radiation field. The interference of the emitted and reflected dipole radiation field, emitted from the excited molecular species and reflected radiation from the metal surface, they interfere and they give rise to what is called image effect. At actually this is less than 100 angstrom. So if the distance of the excited molecule is less than about 100 angstrom units, the dipolar field of the excited molecular species induces surface plasmon modes, and changes the radiative lifetime of the molecular species. Should be actually T greater than 100 angstrom. Below 100 angstrom units, non-radiative energy transfer to metal by a lossy surface waves dominate other decay channels. So in this figure, there is a exponential increase in the lifetime up to certain point. And when the distance from the surface is above around 100 angstrom units, then the lifetime starts decreasing. And as you increase the separation, then lifetime goes higher and then comes down. So this is the distance in angstrom units. So depending upon the separation, different mechanisms are responsible for change in the lifetime. Below 100 angstrom units, the lifetime, it is the radiative and non-radiative, both lifetimes are affected. Above 100 angstrom units, it is the radiative lifetime alone which is affected, and the interference between the electric field of the dipole and the electric field produced by the surface plasmon modes of the metal surface, they interfere and they produce this interference type pattern in the lifetime of the excited states. So, in conclusion, from studies on mono and multi-layer LV films on glass and gold using sub-picosecond time resolved emission, steady state emission, that means normal fluorescence, absorption, reflection techniques, we found that non-radiative lifetime, which is affected by energy transfer within the molecules in the same layer, the rate constant is 1.2 into 10 to the power 9 per second. So if you take inverse of this, that will give you the lifetime due to non-radiative energy transfer within the same layer, which is monomer lifetime is 4.2 nanoseconds. And non-radiative lifetime due to energy transfer between the nearby layers is 2 into 10 to the power 9 per second on glass. On gold-coated substrate, for 1 LV film on gold, the average lifetime is 43 picoseconds compared to 4.2 nanoseconds on glass. For distances greater than 100 angstrom units, radiative rate of the excited molecule is modified due to interference of the radiative field of the oscillating dipole and reflected field from the metal. Reflected field is produced due to excitation of the surface plasmon modes, which is a very characteristic property of metals. For D less than 100 angstrom units, this tau reduces to picosecond range due to non-radiative energy transfer via coupling to surface plasmon modes and molecular dipolar field. So, see, at higher separations, it is the radiative rate. Radiative rate means the molecule, excited molecule, gives out radiation, comes back to the ground state through fluorescence or normal emission process. That lifetime or the lifetime associated with this process is called non-radiative rate. For distances less than 100 angstrom units, time reduces due to non-radiative electron transfer via coupling to surface plasmon modes. So these are two different mechanisms which are operative depending upon the distance of the excited species from the surface. And it has larger implications on choosing proper substrate for particular type of experiments. Say in electronic devices, if you use a gold-coated substrate, the electron transfer rate will increase by several orders of magnitude, and the device's performance will be much faster. If you use glass or ceramic or any non-conducting substrate, the lifetime of electron transfer or the rate of electron transfer will be much slower compared to. So, indirectly, these studies have some bearing on other areas also, catalysis. How long the intermediate complex, which is formed between the species and the catalyst, that is called intermediate species, how long it will remain in that state, the catalyst and the species. So, if it is for very short duration, the rate of catalysis will be slow. If the complex is for longer duration, rate of catalysis may be higher and so on. So, depending upon the type of application, one can try to do this type of experiments and try to understand the implications of these studies. Thank you very much.